Okay, so let's talk about cetaceans a little bit.
All right.
We're here with Patricia Cori, and she's written two books in this order.
Should I close up here?
This one, Messages from the Great Whales and the Dolphins Before We Leave You.
Exactly.
More long than just saying thanks for the fish.
Huh? So, and thanks for all the fish.
Yes. And The Emissary, which is her latest book that we'll be discussing. What got you focused on cetaceans?
What possessed me, people ask me.
Yeah, what possessed you? What possessed you? I mean,
all right, well, years ago I was teaching a workshop because my form of material is very galactic. Syrian Revelations, it's all...
Starseed Transmissions?
Yeah, yes. Well, that's not my book. Starseed Dialogues is one of my books.
Starseed Dialogues, okay.
But yeah, it's...
the genre of understanding reality.
Exactly. And they began... 1996, I came out of a crop circle, kind of fine-tuned and produced a wealth of material. This is my 13th book now.
Wow.
But what happened is about 2 years ago, I was teaching in Jordan, and I was teaching this material, DNA activation, rewriting the genetic material, kind of significantly esoteric information. At the same time, more and more people are awakening to that.
Yes,
the significance of that. Uh-huh. And I... had already been spending a lot of time out in the ocean with whales. I go out as often as possible on boats, as everywhere I go. So if there's a coast and there's water, I'm out with the whales and dolphins.
You mean like in Hawaii and here?
In Hawaii, let's count them all. In off of Nova Scotia, that has huge humpback whale population, where you have to wear these ridiculous, gigantic suits. I'm sure you've seen them.
I haven't seen the suits, but yeah, I know that the Nova Scotia, Newfoundland, that's really...
That's cold. I mean, they were
very cold.
Glaciers in the water, so you have these thermal suits, and it's so funny because it's like a Woody Allen comedy gag, but without them, if you go near the water, you're dead in 45 seconds. And so I have adventured out in many places. Mexico, I've spent time in the with the gray whale nursing area in Magdalena Bay, but... And always loving it, but never swimming with the wild. Still then, I had not swum in the wild with dolphins.
Wow.
And I was teaching this workshop in Jordan, which was itself a challenge. It's another culture. And they're dealing with this woman talking about galactic stuff in a culture where they're not necessarily that open to that. Mm-hmm. And in the middle of trying to share all that information with them, I started hearing the cries of dolphins and whales, and identified those cries as "Please help us! Please help us! Help us!" and thrashing about and psychic images of these whales and dolphins in difficulty.
What?
So much so that here I am teaching this workshop, and I, in the middle of this class, I just lost it and told everyone, "Okay, I took a break." I couldn't really say I'm sitting here with you, but I'm actually in the middle of the ocean drowning with a bunch of whales and dolphins who are dying.
Huh.
So I called the class short and went back to my hotel at the end of the day. Mm-hmm. Barely got through the day. And when I got there on television, there was a report that 150 whales and dolphins had beached at that time in New Zealand, which is the impetus for that part of the book, The Emissary.
Yes.
And I had somehow psychically tapped into that. And this started to occur every 2 months. I'd have another incident. One was in a dream where I woke up. I almost died in this dream state because I was choking, suffocating underwater. And then I woke up to my man calling and saying, "You better turn on the television. Another 100 whales have beached." This happened repeatedly until I started to hear messages. I received the messages that become this book, Before We Leave You. And from there on in, it's whales and dolphins. That's my passion. And that's what I care about most right now on my journey.
Were you familiar with Cetacean Nation?
Yes, very much so. The problem is that he gave dolphins LSD. I've got a problem with that.
Well, he was extreme for his generation.
Yeah, he was. He did amazing work, but that was the only area that I thought he...
Where he went past the species boundary, the speed limit.
Yeah, because the
evolutionary speed limit, as you say.
Yes. It's one thing to take the LSD yourself and then go out and swim with the dolphins, but to actually give dolphins...
Well, that's the thou shalt not alter the consciousness of someone else.
Yeah, that wasn't on, and that wasn't good for his credibility at all.
Yeah.
And, oh my gosh, I wonder what happened to those poor dolphins.
Well, he told me. Actually, I asked him about that.
Yeah, we probably have it on tape.
What did he say?
He said actually he'd given them a combination of ecstasy and acid.
Yikes.
Which is actually probably a little better if they're mammals like us. He said that they formed a circle and they started toning together.
Wow.
He says that the space in the middle of them started to change. Like it became more interdimensional, more like folding space and things like a portal kind of.
Well, but, have you swum with wild dolphins?
Yes.
Silly question. Yeah. They're outside your door.
But I've been to Kealakekua Bay in Big Island.
Oh, wonderful.
And there's a tribe of humans that swim every day with the dolphins.
Is that Joan Ocean included?
She knows
them. It's her bay.
She's there, but she's kind of more the one that's the tour guide for people. But there are people that are hardcore dolphin people that get up and talk to each other at 7 in the morning and make, you know, arrange. They look at which beach the dolphins are at, and they go out and they play the leaf game with them, and they communicate with them. I hung out with them.
We had a camera with us, an underwater camera, and we would get out at 6 every morning and just go swim for 2 hours into the bay and then play with the dolphins.
Oh,
and,
yeah.
There's nothing like it. Yes. Oh, my first swim with wild dolphins was a few years ago in the Azores Islands.
Yeah.
And As a teacher, one of the things that I do in my workshop is really get people to face fear and talk about fear so we can move beyond the fear into the higher joy zones.
Yeah, they start. Their joy is way higher than ours appears to be.
Yeah, appears to be.
Like, it seems like our species ends about where they start. You know, there's that, well, there's a little crossover. But
Our species is creating all the problems that
we don't have as much fun as they do.
We don't. We really don't. The first time I was teaching this another workshop, and somebody said, "Well, what is your fear, Patricia? Don't you have any fear?" And I said, "Sharks." And I don't know where it came from; just popped out. Being a Californian, I think that great white shark fear will always be there.
And dolphins are afraid of sharks too.
Yeah, but they stand up to them. So I go out on the. It's really a funny story. I decided, well, okay, two things: I'm going to walk my talk, and if I'm afraid of something, I'm going to face it. And I need to swim with dolphins, and tank swimming is not what we're talking about. I have to get into the wild, and there are sharks there. So I'm just going to do it and kill two birds with one stone. So I jumped off in the Azores Islands, which is, I don't know if you know where they are. It's a 2.5 hour flight west, from Portugal. And they're somewhat halfway between North American continent and Portugal.
Is it tropical?
It is. It's temperate. Beautiful. Mm. As somebody in the Azores said to me, you can have 4 climates in one day in the Azores. And as he said that, cloud came, bada boom, major storm with hail, and then shum, temperate, steamy heat. It's an exciting place. And I went out there and I said, okay, I'm going to do this. Uh-huh. And I went out on a pontoon boat with the wetsuit up to here. Uh-huh. And I looked at it. As far as I could see, and the captain says, "Wow, Patricia, this is amazing. You've got at least 250 bottlenose dolphins out there.
Wow.
Jump!" And I was all I could see was fins. But how do we know these are dolphin fins? These nana. And he said, "They're dolphins. They're jumping." I said, "But there could be sharks. These are a lot of fins.
Yes.
The wild ocean, and also jumping off a boat in the middle of the ocean—that takes courage. A little teeny boat, big waves." And I jumped in, and that's when I was gifted with the most extraordinary 250 bottlenose dolphins. They stayed with me for 3 hours.
Wow.
3 hours swimming around with them until I finally told the captain, "Look, at this point, I need to go. Otherwise, I'm going to swim away with them and never return." But they were in relaxation mode, and I humbly feel that there was something happening there that they were coming to.
Do you feel any emotions?
Duh.
I mean, I'm curious what the range was.
Well, the first thing is I put out to my readers that I was going to swim with wild dolphins for the first time, and if they had any messages for them, that I would want them to send them. And I got some rice paper and the most excruciating process of getting squid ink and the old-fashioned pen, and painstakingly wrote out on this paper messages of love for the dolphins. And these were some very poignant messages. Don't lose faith. Don't lose faith in the human race. We love you, etc. And I rolled this painstakingly made scroll up and stuck it in my wetsuit. And when I got in, after thrashing around, supposedly if you thrash around they leave, but they were just like, look at the human. And I pulled out this scroll and just put it out like this. There were two sentinels, mm-hmm. just right, had come right in to check me out. Mm-hmm. And I put this scroll out and the rice melted into the water and they started to come. And the process of hearing those echolocation tune-ups, I know what you mean about toning, because they were there to, I think they were there to decide whether or not I would be welcomed into the pod or not. Yeah. And it was like ding, 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 ding. Total tuning program.
A kind of collective group tuning.
Oh, yeah.
Which you resonated with, too.
Yes.
Now, do you think our species could handle more of that kind of vibe? You know, if we put it on our digital 5.1 surround sound speakers and heard that, would it have an effect on consciousness?
I do. I think that that's happening. And my books are, both of these books are about the importance of that sound in the ocean. And how they very possibly are not just limited to mating calls and behavioral
the
patterns.
They have their transmissions to all species.
And what are they doing? I believe that the whale calls and the dolphin calls are about holding the vibration of the ocean together, holding the ocean in balance on this planet. And that may sound far-fetched, but if you consider, I've just been doing some research and I've heard that a humpback whale's call can travel as far as 1,000 miles. Wow. Now, that precludes any discussion of mating calls, because nature would not create something that it took 1,000 miles. I mean, by that point, you'd be saying, yeah, okay, I'm not interested anymore. Let's go get some fish.
Well, the way it could work is that there could be currents, and they could travel inside a current, because the cold keeps the sound bouncing back and forth.
Very true.
And I was just reading that the Navy sonar systems, there are slow rolling waves, and they travel 300 miles.
Well, the Navy sonar is one of my pet peeves.
I know, I can tell.
And I've been coming out very loudly talking about that.
Yes, and from what I've read about it, it's scary in terms of the how loud they are and how they can cause brain damage just by being
there. Well, consider that we know that whales and dolphins have these incredible oral cavities.
Yeah.
And that when pressure sound comes into their experience as pressure, the before we leave you describes it as sound before sound, when this blast of pressure comes in, and then they it starts to vibrate a sound in their immense, these cavities in their heads. And these sonar drills are literally blowing their brains apart. This is too much sound. They're very, very high decibels. Very, very
235
dangerous.
Decibels, you can cause brain damage at 210 decibels.
Exactly. And the news that I'm talking about right now is the fact that the Navy has just gotten the go-ahead to do new 5-year programs, War on the Oceans, supposedly...
For national security reasons.
For security. So. Everything is for security, the new punch word.
Yeah.
And they are going to be doing much more vast weaponry, no more protected marine safeguards. There's a place near Florida where the right whales have a nesting sanctuary. That's fair game. It's going to be chemicals. It's going to be bombs. It's going to be increased sonar levels. And laser sonar, which I don't even know what that is.
Yeah,
and the whales and dolphins are... The Navy has openly said that they could have 13 million marine mammals.
Yeah, they haven't denied that. That's true.
No, they don't deny it. It's almost as if you got a problem with that. And I have a problem with that.
Yeah, you do. So where's the pushback, right? Probably for somebody from New York, at least.
I think eventually somebody's going to have a problem with me having a problem with that.
Yeah.
But we have to speak out about that. There's a beautiful woman whose her name is Rosalind Peterson.
Yeah.
Do you know her?
No. No.
She is one courageous...
Is she speaking out for the Cetaceans?
She's speaking up against this Navy information. In fact, we work together on
something. When I've been in Hawaii, it's always comes more into the news than here.
Yeah. Oh, that's good to know.
Yeah.
But it better start getting into people's news streams here, because 13 million whales and dolphins?
Yeah.
What's
the solution to it in your mind?
You know, Helen, the solution for me, being a warrior, because that's what I am,
yeah,
is to talk, to scream, to petition, to inform, to activate as much as possible, and keep people that on the one level of energy work, to keep that going.
Yeah.
And then on the other, to trust, to believe, to pray, to meditate, and to help raise the frequency of the planet. And it's a beautiful balancing act of how much of it is going to be screaming and yelling, and how much of it is going to be going to that higher place where you know in the end everything is in divine
it's
order.
It's all perfect.
Yeah,
it's
I have a problem balancing those two, because the all perfect people are also sometimes very passive.
And which isn't you.
No, so, that is not me.
But that's the thing, we've got to tune into your own.
Yeah.
It sounds like it's the balance we seek with this.
Yeah. For example, I just did this concert for the whales and dolphins, because I just opened my foundation in 2012, Save Earth's Oceans, Inc.
Mm-hmm.
And our first big event was a fundraising concert in London, which didn't raise very many funds, but did really serve as an awakening for a lot of people. And it was Singing the Oceans Alive, a concert for the whales and dolphins. And we had no less than the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra, and we played the most beautiful music. And 9 musicians who gifted their talent and time to play for them as well. And this concept was, first of all, let's awaken people to the importance of that music.
Mm-hmm.
And let's let the whales and dolphins know that there are humans here knowing, understanding, and celebrating their music.
Well, how about a concert where there are dolphins present?
Well, that would be the next step. But in order to have them present, we actually talked about beaming the music out into the water.
Yeah.
Because one thing I would never be interested in is having a SeaWorld environment.
No, I was thinking the natural outdoor, creating vortexes of laser tunnels that they could
jump through, things like that,
in the water.
Yes.
Maybe near Joan Ocean's place.
That's right. Well, this is something that I'm looking forward to doing with the next one, because I thought, I'll never do this again. This is way too much work. I approached the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra, and I've never done anything like this in my life.
Yeah. So is this a project you actually finished on this?
Yeah, it was April 25th.
April 25th.
And it was a big Hare Krishna on that. It all went well. I was really delighted, because I pretty much did this on my own.
This year?
Yeah, just finished it.
Wow.
Yeah, it was fabulous. Fabulous. Wow. And we got great reviews. And but it was so funny, because when I approached the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra, they said, "Well, Mrs. Cori, what kind of experience have you got putting on concerts?" I said, "None." Why would you be coming to the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra? And I said, "Because you're the best." And so my mom taught me, start at the top and work your way down. And it was a night to remember.
So set the stage for us. What was it like if you were visiting? Was it an outdoor concert?
No, it was in a place called the Fairfield Halls in Croydon.
Uh-huh.
And it was
that's a small town in England?
It's a suburb of England, and it has one of the best acoustic halls in London. And it was the only hall that would let me hire it, because they want to vet you. They want your whole financials. They want experience. You just can't rent a hall in London. I mean, if you think about it, it's pretty wild.
So you dealt with all the red tape to...
I said, okay, let's do it. And then it was, of course, one thing leads to another.
Yeah.
When the Fairfield Hall heard that I had the Royal Philharmonic.
Oh, could they? Yeah,
and they said, well, okay. And little by little, I pieced it together. But I'm really proud of myself, because I didn't have a lot of help.
Yeah. Wow.
And then at the end, so many people came in big time and supported it and me. And we did something very magical, and now they want to take it on the road. So this is the next idea.
What was the main message takeaway you were hoping people would take from the...
The main message was, please listen to the music of the whales and the dolphins. Please listen. Listen to the song of the ocean.
Mm-hmm.
And there's still time. I did a piece, actually, this wonderful composer, Gabriel Currington, he's listening, he knows who he is. He wrote the most extraordinary piece. He's a classical composer, and he wrote a piece that he named The Emissary.
Wow.
And I did the narrative for the piece, and the last words were, there is still time to save the oceans. There is still time to save the whales and dolphins. There is still time before they leave us. That's how we closed the concert.
Wow.
Did you get goosebumps? No?
Did you get this one?
Did you get goosebumps?
There's still time.
Did you?
Well,
I get goosebumps when I look before. There is still time before they leave us.
I believe in that message. I believe there is. And I think we're given the perfect time.
Yeah. And I am excited in regarding the question you asked me earlier. I do think more and more people are ready to hear this. Messages from the whales and dolphins, music of the whales and dolphins, and bring that in on a much higher level than ever before. It's time to close the circus. It's time to stop killing the whales and dolphins. And it's time for the human race to break through. I think we're going to break through.
I feel like we're the ones that are making sure that it does.
Yes, indeed.
I mean, as usual, the species is on the verge of either complete annihilation or mass planetary awakening. You know, we're sort of... but it's like what you said earlier, the balance between just being and doing.
Well, I think you said it well. I think that the human race, as far as my small part of being in this group, looking back over history, it seems that we always have to be up against the wall before we move.
It seems like it.
It seems like it, because it makes sense. If we're complacent and life is easy, we're too busy enjoying ourselves to worry about anything or to make a significant change.
Yeah, why bother?
I mean, what's to change? We're happy. It's working.
That's it.
And so it's only...
The ocean, you know, what else is there?
Exactly. A little beer.
Yeah.
So it's only when we are really in those dramatic moments of questioning our own survival, really, that we move into action. And this is one of those times. Let's face it.
Yeah. And it's also, it's harder if it's not affecting our species. You know, I think our consciousness so far is very species-centric.
But it is affecting our species. It's just that people don't want to really go there. I mean, we've got plenty of things to be concerned
about. No, and also a lot of people in our species eat them.
That's right.
Right? So there's that, too.
So there's that, and there's also Fukushima, the radiation emanating from that. And
we've done some shows on that,
We've
too.
Got some serious issues here.
Yeah,
but
the radiation and...
And here in California, you can't deny that that's an issue. But the question of eating dolphin meat and whale meat...
The cove being a...
And I have a colleague, his name is Hardy Jones, you may know of him. Hardy Jones.
Hardy Jones, is he?
He was the first one to discover the Talgee Cove.
Oh.
In fact, he walked through in the film, but he was the one who discovered
really?
It. Hardy Jones. And he has an organization called bluevoice.org.
Oh, interesting.
And his approach, and he is a beautiful, beautiful spokesperson for the whales and dolphins. His approach is to teach these indigenous people, and particularly the Japanese, how they're killing themselves by eating this meat. So he's going around the world. He's doing blood tests in Japan. He's getting the people to let the medical staff that he supports get blood samples for them, and then look at the mercury in their blood and other toxins in their blood.
Wow.
And this seems to be helping them get it.
Huh.
And it's a great approach. If you can't get them to stop killing whales and dolphins because of the moral issue or any number of issues,
you can show how it's affecting
how
your
it's affecting
directly,
you.
Right?
And so there is an uprising in Japan of people who are really trying to get their own country to stop.
Well, the thing I think that is interesting to people and myself too is how a deep a connection can we have with another species? Like, then can we connect with them like we can a human being, on the level of loving a friend or a relative? I mean,
I'd like to say that there are some humans with whom I communicate much less easily
than
a dolphin or a dog.
Huh? You think
because
maybe we're past we were incarnated as other creatures?
Absolutely. Why not? I always wonder why people have a hard time imagining that we have been a fish or a dolphin or whatever.
Well, and the fetus does change form.
Exactly.
As
but if you see, interesting that you would bring that up, because if you see images of different states of development in fetus, there is a point where they're all the same. Very similar. Mm-hmm. Dolphin fetus at a certain point is almost unrecognizable as another species from human. And then, of course, everything starts to form differently.
Yes.
But why not? Why not?
Yeah, we'd be... Yeah. So maybe that creates a sympathetic resonance for some people who are more part dolphin than others, and they're able to help communicate more with them, with the pods, and then bring that into their species. That's, I guess, the part of the idea of the emissary is that you're between two worlds.
Yes.
And you're bringing the message.
Well, I am a shaman, yeah. So I do walk between the worlds. And then one of those, the aspects of that is being an animal communicator.
Yes. Yeah.
And I don't find it that difficult at all to understand. And for people who do say, oh, come on, you can't be serious. I just say, have you ever had a dog? You know, really? Anyone who's had a dog and has loved the dog must know what it means to communicate without language. Mm-hmm. Because dogs just have to look at you and they tell you everything that's going on. But what I think is happening is that we're going to have language with the dolphins and whales. And John Lilly was doing great work. There's Donna and Jack Kasowitz in Miami. They're making huge progress. And then recently, unfortunately, I just heard a snippet of this, but some researcher was able to, using a computer, actually make out a...
Whistles as language. Yeah. I had that article on the show last week. Inspired by knowing, thinking you were going to be on the show. I got some articles, and one of them was the breakthrough in understanding clicks and whistles.
Yeah, I think we're there. I can't wait. I'm so excited. And that's what my organization is going to be dedicated to, that, to get to research on breaking through the language barrier.
Yeah, and do you think we'd be forming a new language that would be an interspecies language of some sort?
I do. Unless it's Hottentot, because they've got clicks, but wouldn't that be something?
It could be a combination of such languages, right?
But the African Hottentot language is clicks and whistles.
And are they familiar with dolphins as a culture?
I'm not sure.
But coastal culture might be if they are a coastal culture.
I think this is going to happen in our generation, and that we're going to get some big surprises. And remembering that the whales and dolphins are the keepers of the oceans, and they are 5-10 million years old, and we are relatively new as a species, so yes, surely they have a lot to teach us about this planet.
How long have they been there?
There's so many different estimates, but most people estimate that they are as a species at least 5 million years old. And the great blue whale, it's the largest mammal ever to have existed on this planet, and is still here with us.
You were saying in your book about making eye contact while they're dying as a shamanic transition.
Well, in the storyline, of course, it's called a fiction.
Yeah.
And a lot of the reviewers are saying there's a lot of truth in fiction, and Patricia Cori brings that truth through. But in the fictional telling, the heroine, Jamie, is on the beach when she's in the resort of New Zealand when this 150 whales
and dolphins
beach themselves
on the, yeah.
Yeah, and she goes out to help. And in the process of helping, there's a mother, humpback, very pregnant, and Jamie connects with her before she dies. She asks permission to connect with her baby as well. And then let's say you who understand shamanism, she helps them over the rainbow bridge.
Yeah,
and helps them pass over. It's a very poignant scene.
Yes, it really struck me, because they would, in a sense, that would be where there's a convergence of our two species, and the consciousness of the dolphin and the human would become one. Where did you find you most became, connected with that?
Involved. It happened. Predominantly when I jumped into the water and I had that first experience with the dolphins. And it was 3 hours. First of all, because I was really in the middle of the ocean. This wasn't off the coast. This wasn't like in Hawaii where the pods start swimming up and they're very, very close. This was the middle of the ocean jumping off this boat. It was everything, all of my fear bundled up into one. And what happened was, first of all, I had that thrashing about...
Yeah, the
150. There were 250 estimated bottlenose dolphins.
Wow.
And so after that moment of this panic, a dolphin came up. I mean, I'm like this, and I've never been in the deep ocean like that. Wow. I mean, deep. And so I'd never experienced how the sun bounces off the waves, how it reflects down into the water, this diamond of light into the water. It was something so profound for me that I thought this could possibly be where I leave this planet.
Wow.
I think this is, I could just swim away now. Mm. It was this all-encompassing bliss that I've never known before. And then I had these two sentinels doing the ping, 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 ping. And while I was in this mode, this dolphin comes up and hits me in the shoulder. And my first thought was, I'm shark meat.
Really?
Because that's what they do, sharks. Yeah, they bump into you, they come back around, they rip your arm off.
Your worst fears were about to happen.
Exactly,
right?
Because the dolphin was my teacher.
So the dolphin knew.
The dolphin knew.
That you had that fear.
Yeah, of course. And so it hit me like that, and I went, shark meat. And then it moved down my body, the length of my body, rubbed up against me, a wild dolphin in the middle of the ocean, swam down, rubbed down, and then to my fins, and then jumped up, leaped up into the air, and jumped over me. And when it jumped back down, it jumped in and it looked at me, and it went, and off it went. And it was like, I think, some kind of being reborn moment for me, because I was so blown away that this dolphin had come to teach me about my fear and help me get over. And he did exactly what a shark would have done.
Wow.
And the captain of the boat said, we saw this happening. And we said, this can't be happening. This doesn't happen in the wild. I said, well, it happened. And he said, yeah, but we can't believe it happened. It just doesn't happen. Patricia, you were really blessed. And from that point, after he jumped back in, and it's just almost a caricature, really. You know how dolphins do this thing?
Yes.
It's not just when they're trained to do that in circuses. And so he did this thing. And off he swam, and then they started to come up. And there were babies and mothers and more calves and just so many dolphins. And the captain kept saying, are you okay? And I'd come up and swim with them and play with them as if I were in a tank.
Wow.
And after 3 hours, I was so exhausted. And they had somebody jump in. I had hired the boat specifically for me alone, so this wasn't a touristic situation. Mm-hmm. And they had somebody jump in because they didn't think I was going to come back. And I was contemplating, this is where I leave planet Earth.
If I'm going to go, this is a perfect
this
place.
This is it, yeah. And that is in itself, I look back at it and think, how about that? And she jumped in to kind of be a monitor for reality.
Yeah.
So that was a huge,
wow.
huge...
Wow, I see that. That would shift my life, right? My world.
So much so that I took every cent I owned in the bank, and I left the Azores Islands. I went home, and I told my partner, I'm not done. And went got back on a plane, and took out all my savings and bought a house on the island.
Wow.
So that I could be close to them.
Wow.
So that's interesting, isn't it?
It's very interesting, yeah. That would definitely change the direction of everything.
Yeah, and from there, since then, I have been completely, in answer to your question, immersed in the dolphin and whales.
Wow, how long ago did that happen?
That was 2010.
Wow, so this is all really recent.
Yeah. I mean, my love for them has been many, many years, but this swimming with them in the wild, this happened in 2010.
Wow. Did you write really differently before that happened? Was it?
Well, before that, I was doing a lot of channeled books, galactic, very galactic information.
Ah, this kind of brought it into this planet, huh?
Starseed information. Huh. And now I've taken off with The Emissary, which, by the way, I wrote the screenplay first.
It seems very visual.
Good.
Reading it,
And definitely. I think I'm the only author that I've ever heard of that wrote the screenplay to adapt to a novel. And then now I'm writing the sequel, and I'm often running on this new direction. And even the sequel is very much about the whales and their communications for the Earth.
The continuation of the story here, or what happens next after...
Uh-huh. Because people say, you kind of leave us wondering.
No.
And I say, that's deliberate. Hang in there.
I like your props, too. I like the research vehicle being a pleasure craft of the ultimate pleasure craft of the show.
Yeah.
Sets the stage for when you make the movie to be on this.
Exactly. I was just telling my brother, I've been told that when the producer said, we're going to want you on the set. And I said, where are you going to be filming this in Hollywood? He said, oh, no, we're going to rent a super yacht, and we'll be doing that somewhere out in the French Caribbean. Or I said, I can do that.
That's perfect.
I can indeed.
Make sure it has a heliport.
That's what I have to.
Yeah, it's got to be realistic.
And there's that scene that, where, you know, when the helicopter is coming down, and, well, we don't want to give away that part of the book, but there is a scene when they call for medevac, and this helicopter looks down and sees this scene below.
With all the dolphins.
With all the whales.
With the whales, that's right.
Yeah, all around the ship. And
which is reminiscent of your experience with the dolphins a little bit.
Very much so.
Interesting. Now, the difference is that it was totally ecstatic when you had it here, and yet part of the message is that they need us to stop doing some the testing.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And so I would assume that is the real message that's coming through now, too, that there's something they have to tell us as a species. Are their species telling us
exactly
to how to be better stewards for the planet? How to tune into our role here with everybody else and get with the program.
Get with the program.
Get with the program.
Well, in the first book, before we leave you, they actually come out and say this is what the human race needs to do.
Yeah.
And in the Emissary, the storyline is that because she's psychic, she communicates with the whales and dolphins, and they start to appeal to her and say, look, there is great danger for this planet, and it begins with silencing the drums, they call it, that are tearing apart the oceans.
We got to shift our culture away from war-based thinking, right? I mean, that's...
Is there a place on the planet without war now?
Yeah.
You know, it's like, how many more wars do we need before we get this?
Well, yeah, as most of us realize, the military-industrial machine, it just has to feed itself.
I know. The problem is now it's decided it's declaring war on the oceans, and this is one of the themes in the book. It's not enough now that we're warring the entire Earth-bound reality. Now they're going to just start bombing for no reason. They're going to bomb the oceans, and the extreme instruments that they're using, weapons, for what purpose?
Yeah, at what point would the Gaia organism push back?
Well, we've seen that point already in many different places, where we've got 9.3 earthquakes, which is one of the suggestions in the story.
But the earthquakes themselves are being triggered by our actions and stuff.
Yeah. Fracking is doing a wonderful job on the Earth.
Yeah.
The debate about whether we have real global warming or whether it's a natural process for the Earth, and I say, well, gee, we know that the military is 45 years ahead of us as far as anything we're being told they're using, and we also know that one of the primary directives of that complex, the industrial military complex, is weather control. So it doesn't take a genius to figure out that perhaps there's some intervention in our weather patterns. So the human race has to start...
It's waking up to the...
Waking up. And we are.
Yeah. Yeah, a little bit at a time.
We are.
I have a question.
Go for it.
Is there any person that you would pick out of your knowledge bank who you think could do the most good? What does that person... Yeah. Who is that person? What can that person do?
Boy, that is a very good question. We need some heroes on this planet and some very powerful peace leaders. And at the moment, I'm wondering who that might be.
Well, a lot of good people have been sidelined because they don't want to play the military-industrial game.
Right, or been removed.
Yeah, and if you get too uppity.
Yeah, it's like first they take your first grown child. Just kidding.
Yeah, well, it's serious monkeys.
I think that's a very good question. I would like to say that at one point it might have been His Holiness the Dalai Lama, because he still does have that broad impact. But I think we need somebody a little bit stronger than that, who has knowledge of how to unite the technology world with the conservationists, somebody with more... more than just being the leader of compassion on this planet, that has the ability to awaken the different factions that are going to be able to work together to make change. Yeah. I can't think of a single person who can do
maybe
that.
Maybe it's a collaborative consciousness of some
indeed.
Sort. Maybe instead of just indeed. Being one. Maybe we're moving away from the hierarchical oneness to a more of a collaborative oneness.
Yeah, and I think also the indigenous people are if they can become empowered once again, I think the indigenous people have new, old ideas for new paradigm that can be brought forward and mutated into.
Absolutely, yeah. No,
let's face it, I think the technology industry is going to be a big player here.
Oh, yeah, it is. And it is ripe for being used in conscious ways. You know.
But the question remains, and that is, how much more do we need of war? And what's it going to take for the complex, as you called it, to stop?
Yeah, well, stop getting funding. You know that's part of it.
Yeah.
And does the system have to collapse or dissolve, or can it to evolve? You know, as another thing people are wondering.
I think that a lot of the old has to go, and
yeah.
We just don't. We can't perceive what that would be like.
It's like
our idea.
Revolution or evolution?
Yeah.
You know, what's
well, maybe both? Well, I am very comfortable with the idea that we are already well along in our communication with extraterrestrials.
That's normal. That's not.
It's kind of a given here.
Yeah.
And of course, there's so much postulation about whether they're good ETs or bad ETs and whatever.
That's the dualism.
Yeah, exactly.
The very species or kind of thinking.
And the polarity of this planet.
Yeah.
But I do think there are some very difficult beings that are working with the government, and we've got so many proofs of that, and spokespeople that have come out and talked about underground bases and things like that, and it's one of my favorite subjects.
No.
But one of the things that I find very exciting, and I talk about a lot, is why wouldn't there be underwater bases, which is a theme in the Emissary. And we got reports of bases all over the world. People have reported sightings of craft going in and out of the ocean.
Yeah, it makes sense. Yeah.
That would get the whales and dolphins' attention, wouldn't it?
I guess it would. I guess it depends on, you know, how they hang with our other species too. You know, I mean, how enlightened are the aliens?
I would like to think that any aliens that are splashing in and out of our underwater scenarios are enlightened enough at least to have some sort of mastery over technology, because they're coming in and out unobserved by and large, and that probably something moving those craft has most likely to do with altering space, altering the vibration of space, and the space around the craft. And that would mean altering the sound waves and space in the water.
Which would definitely affect them.
So I propose that as a fictional possibility, but I think it's a very real possibility.
Yeah. And that if we had underwater experiments like underwater harp towers and that sort of thing, that would definitely something that the aliens would probably be aware of too, as well as
exactly,
dolphins.
And that is also a theme in the book. And just a week ago, I read an article that said that NASA was preparing to line the oceans with towers that will serve as drone bases in the oceans.
Just like autonomous submarines.
Yeah, but they're towers lining the oceans, which is exactly what is described in the Emissary.
They just announced that, and you had written that probably about a year before that.
Yeah.
So.
This happens a lot with my books, whereas the more outlandish concepts then years later become validated by NASA or by some government declarations, which is fun. Helps me keep grounded enough to know I'm not completely crazy.
What was your source for this in this case? Did it come from spirit, or was it more of a something you just spontaneously
I think it came from spirit. I mean, when I embark upon writing, I have no outline. I have no research. I just kind of go. And in the Emissary, it describes that there are these towers lining the ocean floors, and there are these drums that are the reference to the sonar. And so, I thought it was really interesting when I heard about these towers being placed in the ocean floor.
Yeah, it is very interesting. ironically enough, the original high-tech tower was by Tesla,
right?
Yeah, in Long Island, and that was a tower that was supposed to give the world free power. So, what do you see as we should do next? What's happening with both in the real world and in the story, in the fiction story?
Well, in the story of the Emissary, a great catastrophe is looming, and the whales and dolphins are trying to tell the human race to stop the sonar, to stop the harp, to stop all of the electronic maneuvering around the weapons, the great weapons around this planet.
Yeah.
And it is an ecological warning as much as it is fiction. And I'm using fiction as a venue to be able to reach people that don't want to hear or be preached to or don't want to contemplate the situation currently on this. Too scary, right? Yeah. And so what we can do now is to become aware, as many people as possible have to become aware of what's going on this planet so that we can reverse it. It's pretty simple. And as overwhelming as that can sound, taking back the power from the military, taking back the power from the industrial military complex, we have certain things that we can do as individuals, like not using the products, not using the plastic, and speaking our truth, and then doing everything that we possibly can to heal the oceans. This is rule number one, or let's say step number one. And I think it begins with the reaching that critical mass of human consciousness where we can tip the scales back to bringing the earth back to balance. And we're doing it right now, aren't we?
More peace to it.
Yeah.
Is there just a way we can relate holistically to the ocean so that we're not fighting? It's just we're more in tune.
Needless to say, every step that we take as individuals matters. So I personally have been a vegetarian for 28 years because I believe that eating animal flesh and that bloodlust keeps us in killing mode. And I'm going to get a lot of resistance to that statement. Probably you'll get a letter. But I think that vegetarianism is a very important aspect of becoming conscious of our surroundings, conscious of our relationship to nature. But then occasionally I have eaten a piece of chicken because in Egypt, for example, when I eat only vegetables, I almost die from the bugs, right? So my message is do the best you can and be as conscious as you possibly can with every single thing that you do. Own it, honor it, and do what you can to affect change. And we know that eating fish is becoming more and more toxic. Before long, we simply won't be able to. The radiation, the mercury poisoning. I mean, people that are still eating sushi, they're silly.
Yeah.
It's not good for you. But then again, and this is what we were talking about earlier, there's also the idea that, however, when you fear these actions and things, you is it more damaging, the fear that you do, telling yourself or your body to fear them creates illness? What's more powerful, doing it and just saying I am whole, I am one, I am always in balance? It's a balancing act. However, I think that overall, there's a beautiful ocean out there. There's a lot we can do to make it better, and it starts with plastic. We won't even start talking about plastic. And whenever I'm near a beach, I go around and pick up the plastic. Now that's a small gesture, but if we all did that, we wouldn't have 5 islands of plastic out in the ocean.
Yeah.
So it starts with each and every one of us.
In terms of, you recommend also trying to hang out with dolphins and whales as much as possible, just to check it out, just to go out there and...
I mean, if you have the privilege of... Many people that I talk to say, you're so blessed. It's just so unbelievable. Get yourself out to them. There are many places in the world where you can go swim with dolphins.
Yeah.
And
just try it.
Some people say, yeah, but we're messing with their environment or we're interfering. And I say, well, it's better than killing them. And I feel when I'm out there that they are curious. They want to know more about us. So get out of the sea worlds. I'd like to see them all close. But if you have a chance to go out on a boat where in certain places in the world you can jump off a boat and swim with dolphins.
Do it.
It'll change your life.
Books by Patricia Cori.
All right. Well, here is The Emissary, and it is just off the presses. It's just come out in March. And it's available everywhere. Good bookstores and, of course, Amazon and all of the channels. And I like to tell people, please buy a book in a bookstore because we want to keep the bookstores thriving. So I would love for you to pick that up. And you can also learn more about it by checking my site, theemissary.net. Hmm. There's more information about it that. And this is the other, Before We Leave You. And it also is available everywhere in fine bookstores as well. So,
okay.
And my website is patriciacori.com for more information.
Thank you, Patricia.
Thank you.